get used to this after a while?
Of what?
Having an entourage and having all these people taking care of you and watching you and...
No, it's not that normal, but there's really only two people watching me. Everybody else is doing their thing. Everybody's just doing their job. Everybody's doing their job.
Well, you're an old pro at this point.
Am I?
Do you feel like
one? I guess so. I don't know. I've been doing this for... I really started when I was 19. I did a movie when I was 16, but... Mm-hmm. Then I went back to school, and you know what's interesting is that like I was really lucky to get a great opportunity very young. My first job was one of the starring roles in a big Warner Brothers movie, Sister of the Traveling Pants, and so while that was really fortunate, it also was tricky because I'm learning in front of everyone. So I didn't have the opportunity to go off and learn my craft and then present it to everyone. I learned while doing it. So I was fortunate to have that, but also I look back on, I can't even watch older movies.
Were you just a high school actress?
No, I was in show choir. Glee is based on my high school. So It was, it was so much fun. If I could be professionally in show choir for a living, I would, but I can't sing or dance. And
because
I was really excited to be there, and I had a very big performance face, so they put me in the front row a lot because there were amazing singers and dancers that were just kind of saying the words, but I would be like, you know, like big over the top face. So that's how I ended up in show choir, and I just loved it so much, and I loved being on stage, which is interesting because I've never done it as an actor, but you had the support of 43 other people who were great at what they were doing, so, and they were doing the exact same thing as you, so you could get away with not being perfect.
Was acting an inevitability given your family?
Yeah, I never wanted to act because my family, they're all actors, and so I thought, I didn't have anything against it, but I just thought I want to carve my own path and find what I want to do. And it was the thing that I was groomed for without any of us realizing it, my family included. I grew up on sets. My parents had acting classes my whole life that I went to because I'm such a shy person by nature. So being in those classes made me really break out of my shell, and improvisation was something that I still use on my day-to-day life every moment. I mean, improvisation is something that just when my husband and I are having a conversation trying to make each other laugh, we're going back and forth, and it's not something we're doing on purpose. We're improv-ing now, you know. It's like it's things that I do with my best friends. So so much of the foundation of who I am was created by my family being in the business.
And then whatever, you got sucked into the vortex by Warner Brothers.
Yeah, no, my brother tricked me. He actually made me learn the lines, because he said he had an audition and he needed my help. So he made me do these lines with him for so many hours so I could do them upside down and backwards. And we went into the audition and he signed in, and then the casting director came out and said, "Blake?" And Eric said, "Yep, that's her." And I just thought I was gonna die. And she said, "We don't have you on our call sheet." And he said, "Oh," and he put his agency's name. And so I auditioned, and I didn't know what to say in that moment. I was 16, and my brother had just written my name on a piece of paper, and they were looking at me, so I walked in the room and did the audition. So he tricked me into doing that. And then I don't know how he continued to trick me into going on auditions. I think he leveraged it. I think he was going to take me on vacation or something. I can't remember how. And then I got Sisterhood. And then I went back to school for my senior year of high school and thought, I'll defer college for a year and just try this out and see what happens. And at the end of that year, when I decided I was going to go back to school, I met Josh Schwartz and Stephanie Savage, who brought Gossip Girl to me. And what was interesting about that is they were at the forefront of blog. I mean, they were so smart because they looked at what fans had been saying. So this is before people were on social media and giving their opinions, the fans. It was really just the people in suits that decided who was going to get what job. But they, because of Sisterhood, fans of the book of Gossip Girl said, this girl would be a great Serena. And so they thought, well, I bet you we will, if we listen to the fans and cater the fans now and show them that we hear them and we see them and we respect them and we're making it for them, then we immediately have their loyalty and love in such a more powerful way than just if we decide who we think the best person for the job is. Let them decide. And now that happens so often in so many industries, but yeah, they were one of the first to do it. They're the first to do it that I was aware of. So they brought the show to me, and I said, no, I'm gonna go back to school. And they said, okay, you can go to Columbia one day a week, or maybe 2 days a week if it really slows down. It's not full time, but at least you'll feel like you're doing it simultaneously. And they said after the first year, it'll really slow down. And then if we're lucky enough to make it even into a first year or even be on the pilot, and then it'll slow down and then you can go to school a couple days a week. And it just got busier and busier. And
so you weren't hungry, ambitious at that point? You really
I was very hungry and very ambitious. I just didn't think that acting was the career that I was hungry and ambitious for.
What did you think it was?
I had no idea. I just wanted to go out. I wanted to go to a great school, get an amazing education. I wanted to go find my own way and find what I loved and find what I was good at and find what I was bad at and lean into that. Mm. And I found that with acting plenty. But I also found moments of things that I was good at with acting too. And so for me, it's just been, it's been as rewarding and challenging as any job I ever could have dreamed of. But it's just the one thing that I thought I wouldn't do. Mm. So I sort of struggled with it for most of my career. I thought, oh, this isn't what I'm really gonna do. I'm just gonna do this for a year while I defer college, or I'm just gonna try this out and then I'm gonna go back to high school, and I did. And then I'll just defer college for a year and try it out and then I'll go to school. And then at the end of that, I thought, okay, I'll just do this show and then I'll have enough money that, you know, I can put some aside for college fund. And then the show lasted 6 years, and then that was my profession. And so,
Are you hypercritical, or is there room for that on a series, or just kind of go through it?
I am hypercritical, so that's what was challenging for me on series, is I'm such a perfectionist, and I hold myself to a higher standard than anyone. So being on a show where we learned our lines during Last Looks, when we weren't given scripts, it was really a pop culture, like the way that they hired me is reflective of the way that the show was run. Mm. So it was really about leaning into the young audience, feeding this pop culture machine, leveraging our personal lives with our lives on the show, and the outfits, the locations. I mean, that's why the show was so fabulous, is because of all of that stuff. But as an actor, you're not planning your arc or your character. You're just trying to say the lines, not even as naturally as possible, because it's a heightened reality. It's a genre mm-hmm. show. So you're not trying to say them as naturally as possible. You're trying to say them as sort of fun as possible, in a way where you don't sound like a person who learned them 3 minutes ago. So, and you're hitting your mark, and you have to block the scenes in a way where, like, this is how I'd actually walk in the room, and this is how it'd play out. You have to block the scene knowing you have 9 pages to shoot that day, so you really just walk in, and it's like this, where you'd really be moving or doing other things. So it's really, it was about cranking it out more than anything else. And that's hard, but it also teaches you a lot, too. You know, you learn really hard work. You learn having to like be on your feet. You learn, having to work with a crew. I mean, it was such a group effort because we shot. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we were shooting 3 episodes at once, in all different locations. So it was really, really intense. And we were also young that they worked us in a way that now we'd be like, I don't know if we should work this many hours a day.
I have an agent to keep me from doing this.
But they're 24 hours in a day, because I'm on hour 28 now, and this is very confusing. So it helps.
And also super famous, all of a sudden, instantly.
There was less of an awareness of that, because we all lived in New York City, and the show was based in New York City, and there's a very specific love for New York City shows and people on New York City shows that you experience there. So when you are on Sex and the City, I imagine, and you're in New York City, it's more heightened than if you're somewhere else in the world. And I think that, so we sort of felt like we were sort of like hometown heroes, you know, but if we left our hometown, it wouldn't be as, the outreach wouldn't be as great. But that was the craziest thing for us, is to go to Dubai or China and just see that it was exponentially greater there. All
Which
over the
is
world.
Great or scary or?
Greater, I'm saying, in size.
No, I mean, is it great to have that to suddenly, you know, realize that you're paparazzi are chasing you and all that stuff.
Yeah, that's it's very strange. It's a very unnatural thing. I think that people, by nature, crave recognition, but they also crave, they also need anonymity. So it's a very, I think that human beings in general, we do better when we have anonymity because it's unnatural to be chased around like that. But yet we all want to accomplish things where we experience something where we can leave our mark. So we sort of want both things. But you never want people chasing you around. You what you really want is to do great work, to be able to be a part of great films. And then, yeah, it's fun to get to wear the gowns and have the celebrations on the nights that are allotted for that. But you think, well, let's just keep it to those nights. Let's keep right. the attention to days like today. And then tomorrow I'll just go back to my real life. But it doesn't work that way. And it's sort of, you realize, you feel like it's very unfair when you're young that it doesn't work that way. And then you realize, oh, I can't really have it both ways. So, so yeah, I mean, it's like, it's not anything to complain about. We're lucky. If these are the things we're complaining about, we're very, very fortunate.
Well, I mean, ultimately, it's interesting as an artist. You know, you have, it's not, because there are two different, it's almost like there are two different tracks that are going on, or three different tracks, and three include real life.
Yeah.
And one definitely affects the other. I mean, I think it seems to have a, it takes a toll, or sometimes it's
Well, it's actually harder to do your work the more well-known you are, because you can't disappear into a role, because people feel like they know you. And what's interesting, especially in this era with social media and blogs, is that there's such a desire to know everything about someone, and if they don't know everything about you, they just make it up. And so every sort of persona has a personality or a love life or a this or that assigned to them. So we feel like we know these people, and then when we see them play a character, it's really hard to wash away the thing that we're inundated with all day, every day on our phones and on our TVs and papers. So yeah, I think it makes it harder as an artist to do your work when you're trying to pretend to be other people, when people feel like they know you so specifically and they're so overloaded with this idea that they have of you.
And are they right at all?
Usually not, but there are moments where they can be right. Yeah, for sure. But usually it's just sort of an oversimplified, palatable, and more salacious version. I think that what's been interesting to me is to see that people are so much less interesting in the best way than the tabloids make them out to be. Everyone's so much more boring. Their lives are so much more boring in the greatest way. It's not the scandalous soap that that the media makes it out to be. But sometimes it is.
Well, parenting is not incredibly glamorous. Activity.
It's not, but it's sure is great. It can be glamorous. It can be. I think so. I think it can be glamorous because there's nobody that makes me feel like, there's nobody that makes me feel as good as I feel when my daughter says, "Mama, wow, you look beautiful." Or that is just like, ugh. Other than my husband and my baby girl. I mean, those are. That's the truest compliment to me. So so yeah, that's when it feels glamorous. Or I get really excited when I have gowns to try on because I know my daughter will be excited about that. I'm only saying one daughter because the other one doesn't speak yet. But I'm sure she'll be excited. And maybe she won't. Maybe she'll just, like, you know, care about cars, which is great. Or books, that would be better. But yeah. And yeah, this is our job. So while our job can be quite glamorous, it's still our job, and our kids know that and understand that. They don't have, their head isn't wrapped around the other side of it yet. It's just that mommy and daddy go to work, and they come. Yeah. And we're lucky to have them come with us, because most people can't bring their kids to their office every day. So every day is take your daughter to work day for us, and that's we're really, really lucky to be able to do that.
So you get through 5 years of 6 years of television, but you get through the fourth, fifth year. I assume at that point you feel like you've got the craft completely down. You know what you're doing. But does the art? Are you feeling like you know what you're doing as an actor in the process of that, or are you still
It's a different craft. I mean, after 4 or 5 years of doing the TV show, you have the craft of doing that TV show down, because every TV show is different. There are shows that shoot 9 episodes, 7 episodes a season, and they take a few weeks an episode, where we were cranking out 3 episodes at once, and they would be a 1 week episode. So it was just like we were, so that system you have down, but it's a completely different craft than acting. So, and you also have to unlearn a lot of bad habits, which is like, oh, when I walk into a scene, let's just block it like this, because this is all we have time for. You actually have the ability to really explore it for the first time, physically, emotionally. And, you know, we would, most of us would do movies on our hiatus. And so there were, we would get just moments here and there. But what was strange is because the show took up 10 months of our year, we were acting for a long time, yet we never really had the opportunity to work on our craft because we were doing a different type of thing. So it's like we'd been in the industry for a while, but hadn't really seen how we could sculpt ourselves and disassemble ourselves, and how we could disappear and how we could play. Yet we were more known, so it was even harder to disappear. So it's sort of an interesting thing to figure out as an actor, of like what roles can I do where I don't just disappear from the audience that feels like they know me, which is especially tricky because, you know, I dated the same guy that my character dated. I wore the same clothes that my character wore. I went to fashion shows and my character went to fashion shows. I mean, it was just like it walked like a duck, it talked like a duck, but it wasn't a duck, you know? And I could not have been more different than my character. And to me, that was especially heightened by the fact that I was wearing the same clothes, yet I was such a different, living in such a different skin, or I was dating the same guy, yet we were both so different than our characters and our relationship was so different, or that I was going to shows, but it was such a different life. So to me, it was more more amplified how different we were, but I think to everybody watching, it was more heightened how similar we were, because it looked the same. So then as an actor, you have to work even harder because people feel like they really have an idea of you, because they've seen you on screen as this person, they've seen you off screen as the same person, so you have a double reflection of that person that you have to fight. So that's why a movie like this, like All I See Is You, where I dyed my hair brown, we did the scar on for her accident, just like a very raw, virgin look was really important to us. It was very raw and it was very exposed. I mean, it was the first time that I've done any level of nudity in a film, and it was important to be physically, emotionally exposed in every way, and to see what comes off of that, because the version that you see often is like the version that's all, you know, done up, or, you know, it's not the exposed raw version.
So it was a very conscious turn for you in general?
I think it wasn't that I was just looking for this specific thing, because the first movie I did off of my show was Age of Adeline, which could not have been more fabulous in the hair and the makeup looks and spanning from all the decades. But the character required that, and it was just something that I loved, and I felt like I could disappear because it was all these different time zones, and the dialect, the accent was different, the way she speaks. And so to me, I felt like I could take that and really become a different woman. Same thing with Cafe Society, is that took place in the 1930s, so I could become a different woman. The Shallows is something where I've never been stranded fighting for my life on a rock, but it was very, very different than anything I've ever experienced or anything I've ever been a part of, that I felt like that I could disappear into that. And with this, with All I See Is You, was the biggest turn, the biggest arc. It was the most different from any character I'd ever done, and I just loved it.
And does it feel different in terms of doing the work?
How? Does what feel different?
Does acting feel different? Do you feel like you're...
When?
That as you're going into these other projects and you're looking to stretch and find other things, are you finding... Is the act of acting different? Are you challenging yourself in ways as an actor that you hadn't before, and as you say, unlearning tricks that you had?
A lot of it's about opportunity, honestly. You know, I'm lucky to be in a position where I have a nice amount of opportunity, but even then, especially for women, you're the you're this objectified, either one-dimensional character who's like the prize for the man, or if you do get to be a little bit gritty of a character, it's so hypersexualized, it's so glamorized that you don't really get to be flawed. You never get to be flawed as the hero of the story. It's if you get to do this great little character piece. I love doing that role in The Town because I shot for 7 days, but she was just this incredible wild card, and that was so rewarding because I got to go so far because I didn't carry the movie, so you didn't have to worry about liking her or not. I got to really, really push it. And that's really the biggest thing that you hear as a woman is like, oh, we just want to make sure she's likable. I've never heard them say that about any character my husband's ever played. We want to make sure he's likable. You never hear that. It's something that everybody's really worried about with women, which is like, just shows the mentality. So yeah, it's hard to get to play a really bold, distinct character when you're having to always toe that line of like, let's make sure she's likable, or let's make sure she's attractive enough that men, you know, desire her. And that's the nice way of saying what they say. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's tricky because we're so much more dimensional as women than we get to be in film. And so a lot of it's about opportunity. And then the opportunity is so narrow for women that then the competition is greater than the opportunity. And there's so many great actresses out there that have earned the position they're in. And there's so many great actresses out there that have earned a better position than they are in, you know? And so, yeah, there's very limited roles. So when I find a film like All I See Is You with a director like Mark Forster, I just feel so lucky that it came my way, because more than anything at the time, I'm just thinking, how did this come to me, you know?
So how did it come to you? I mean, did you get a call from Mark or?
Yeah, I got a call from Mark. I don't know how Mark, I have to ask him. I don't know what movie or how I was on his radar, but yeah, he said he wanted me to read the script, and if I liked it, he wanted to meet, and we met, and we had a great conversation, and we agreed with so much visually. We actually had a dear friend in common, which is Ryan Knighton, who's sitting behind you. He was telling me about his friend who he was consulting with, who had lost his sight, like, you know, our character Gina, in very different ways, but, and I said, oh, I have a friend as well, what's his name? And he said, Ryan, and I said, Knighton? And so it was just this crazy coincidence that we had a friend in common, which felt very serendipitous. And we both leaned on Ryan a lot to help us, Mark, in the writing process, and then also even in sound design. When I did ADR for the film, instead of speaking into a traditional microphone that's just flat in front of you, I spoke into a microphone that was shaped like a human head. So it was this foam head, because sound travels differently when it's recording it this way and across the different planes of your nose and your face and your cheekbones. Than it does when it's just right here flat or right here on a little mic.
Right.
My hair's on. Making sure the sound was a really authentic experience is really critical to Mark. The visuals, something that Mark discovered when speaking to a lot of different people, was that, and I don't know if this is true for everyone, but this is true for the people that Mark was speaking with, was he said that a lot of times, he said, when you're not seeing something, do you imagine it or do you just listen? He said, well, no, we imagine it, but he said, well, what is it like? Do you imagine just like a normal room? And the thing that fascinated him most is he said, no, that's sort of boring. We just sort of let our imagination run wild. And so that's why in scenes where I'm swimming in the pool, it turns into this beautiful, expansive sea. There are these moments where she's experiencing one thing, but the visuals take you to another place. And we all do that. We all imagine things in our head or go off in our own train of thought. But if we had to close our eyes, we would exist in that much more than when our eyes are open. We're seeing one thing, but we're sort of imagining a parallel other thing. But if you had your eyes closed, then you would just only be living in that parallel other thing.
So was the conversation with Mark key to you wanting to do this, or was the character on the page?
Definitely. The character was on the page. It was a beautiful script, but it was something that, it was a very strange script, because it would say, okay, when from this point forward, the movie's going to be blurry, and then you're going to be able to see here, and then it's going to go back to being blurry here, and then she's swimming in the pool, and then there's this expansive ocean. I mean, it was just sort of, it was It was very visual, yet you're reading text. So they tried to articulate visuals in text, which is sort of impossible to do. So it was key in that you had to say, what the heck does this, what are you talking about?
Right.
What, like, how does this not, what are you talking about? Because I filled in the blanks with my imagination, but how does this manifest itself in your world or your imagination? And so seeing the visuals that he had was just so beautiful, so brilliant.
And how hard is it on set? I mean, Jason's trying to act with you and not getting, I guess, anything from your eyes the way you normally would on a set, or is he?
That was, I think, hard for both of us, is that you know, normally you're doing a really emotional scene and we're looking in each other's eyes and crying. I'm telling him that I can't conceive. And you realize how much you use that as a crutch. It was really hard for me not to look in his eyes to cry. When I had to look just off of his eyes, just like this, it's just, you're losing that connection. So I had to find other ways to connect with him emotionally. So it actually made my job a lot harder, but it was so, I also think that's why it's the performance I'm most proud of, because it made my job harder. I had to really find it deeper within rather than just finding it more on the surface, because you can when you have your eyes, you know, it's like that's the window of the soul. You just look at someone and they're emotional and you're emotional, and then boom, it's there.
Yeah.
But you have to connect on such deeper levels.
Well, I think with actors, that's what, you know, what we see as an audience, mm-hmm. is so much of it is through their eyes.
Yeah.
You know, either the person can do that trick or can't.
Yeah.
And, you know,
yeah,
it's a given.
Yeah.
Some people convey everything, and some people can't convey anything.
Yeah,
it's
like,
why?
Yeah.
Because there's some great stage actors who just don't work on film.
Yeah.
It's kind of like, what happened?
Huh. Yeah, it's interesting. It's interesting. But yeah, I mean, what's neat about this movie is that we as the audience, there's something voyeuristic about it, in that we as the audience see so much of her for so long and see the emotion in her eyes and what she's feeling and experiencing, but she doesn't. And that's also what we as the audience are almost in her husband's perspective in that time. And then suddenly when she can see everything, and it was an interesting turn to me as someone reading the script, as an audience member and as an actor.
So when you see it put together, was it surprising to you, or were you so into it that you already kind of had a sense of where you'd be?
It was both. It was both. I really love seeing all the visual effects, because, you know, it was just something that Mark had described, and they are so abstract that it's hard to describe. So yeah, it was exciting to me, but not surprising, because I feel like he really did what he set out to do.
Yeah. And is it emotional when you see something that you're proud of come together?
Yeah,
is it a different experience than
it is. This whole movie was a really emotional experience. We also had a DP who he would, you know, you block, this is exact opposite of what I was talking about before, which is we would block a scene, sort of, but if we felt like moving somewhere else, he would just move with us. He was operating all the time. But then you're also assuming, okay, he's on my face, unless we're doing a special shot that's of something different. But he would just suddenly, in the middle of a screaming, crying scene, he'd just pan down and start filming my hands. And tears are pouring out of my eyes, and this guy's shooting my fingers. What is he doing? Get up here. This is the good stuff.
I'm giving you the
it's
money.
It's happening. And I'm sorry. I didn't realize I had my phone in my pocket, and it's buzzing. He's probably telling me to say nicer things about him. It's my mom. So he'd suddenly start filming my hands or my feet. But what was interesting is that to him in that moment, my hands were telling so much more of the story than my face. And I had to be so much more, it was sort of chicken or the egg. I don't know if I was more alive and awake as an actor, because every part of me was up for grabs while he's filming. My mom will call 7 times in a row. She's that person. She's the one who thinks that, like, on time 6, you just, like, didn't see that she was calling. So she's just gonna keep calling. It's on airplane. Or maybe he was filming my hands and my feet, because for the first time I was acting with my hands and my toes and my elbows and my knees in a way that I never was before. Because if that sense of sight is taken away, then you're using so many more senses to navigate around the world or tell your story.
So do you feel free now to try everything? I mean, what is the next
What does that mean?
Well, in terms of trying, I mean, you apparently you're not going to sing if you didn't think you can sing.
I sang in this movie.
Well,
did you see the movie?
I did see the movie. But I mean,
we're going to give you a pop quiz.
There's going to be a pop quiz every minute of it. Yeah. It's a complicated pop quiz, though.
Yeah, it would be complicated. Images. Yes.
But I mean, is everything on the table? Or are you now like at a moment where you're kind of, okay, that whole Gossip Girl thing is behind me and I'm done the movies that are, because it feels like the movies that you've chosen are each a departure in a different way.
Yeah.
And what is next? What is like, what would be your dream of the next 2 or 3 years of what comes to you?
Well, the movies I just did are pretty in line with that. I just did a movie with Paul Feig called A Simple Favor and Anna Kendrick, and that movie was so much fun. I got to play so many different women within one. And with Paul, you know, he has a natural inclination towards being comedic, because he's just so funny and delicious and fun. And so it's sort of a noir film. It's a thriller by the script, but it's not a thriller at all. It's just like, you know, you watch any old Bette Davis movie and you're laughing half the time, but the story is intense, but because the characters are so delicious and over the top and fabulous. So this is the same sort of thing, where the characters are just so over the top and divine that that it's really funny, or was to me. At least I think I made a comedy. I don't know. No, it's not a straight comedy by any means, but we were laughing a lot. So it's just a really, really fun, really interesting movie. Such a fun character. And then I'm about to do a movie with Rita Moreno, The Handmaid's Tale, and Barbara Broccoli, who's, you know, Miss Bond. Mm-hmm. And it's a movie about a woman living in London who is a heroin addict and a prostitute, but not in the way that you see in movies where it's always sexualized and glamorized. It's the way that you see in real life, where you just think like, oh, this is so disturbing and this is so tragic. Because this movie's made by a bunch of women, so we're not saying, well, the guys have to want to, you know, bang her. Let's make her a sexy heroin addicted prostitute. It's like, no, we're going to show how tragic this life is and trust that people are open enough to really watch a person turn their life around. And she becomes an assassin. But what's interesting is she becomes an assassin not because she's a prostitute become assassin, like you would think. But she's somebody who has nothing left to lose. She's a walking dead person already. She's already killed herself in so many ways. And when she finds out her family's death wasn't an accident, she just goes to get revenge. And because she has nothing to lose, because she knows she's going to die, each time she just makes it that much further because of that bravery. So what's actually cool about it is that she's not good at being an assassin. She just has nothing to lose. So she just goes in and she makes it beyond so many of these people who are trained. And so to see car chases that aren't these amazing professional car chases, but the car chases of a person who's just trying to make it one more second in life and knows that they may go at any moment, it's just really, it's really, really brave, really cool.
So are you hopeful for women in this business in general? I mean, it sounds like you're finding interesting roles and not doing the things you don't want to be doing. And
I think that it's nice. I feel like there's a little bit of an uprising for women right now, and I think that that's really important because we perpetuate it as much as anyone while thinking, oh, well, these are the opportunities that are out there. Oh, this is how it is. But when you learn that you can create your own opportunities and it doesn't have to be this way. I mean, I've been doing this since I was 19, really, and 30 now, so 11 years, and I've worked with one female director in that entire time. Other than my show, there were a few female directors that came on a show, but in films, I've worked with one female director. And sometimes female producers, sometimes, but more often than not, male producers. Mm-hmm. So to be doing a film with a female director, a female producer, me at the center of it, it's such a rare thing. And it's not that, oh, I only want to make movies with women, but it's just so imbalanced. If men are telling the stories, then naturally they're going to be telling stories for men better than they are women, because they're not women. So giving women opportunities to tell stories just naturally creates more authentic and more dimensional characters and opportunities.
Yeah, I also think that there are a lot of that conversation about women doing things. It's not just women making stories about women. I think if women are making things, that they're also making things about men.
Of course.
That are different than necessarily what.
Of course.
It's not just gender. It's their artists who are out there.
Of course. And people, that's something that people think, oh, this is a female-driven story, so we really want a female-driven filmmaker. But you don't say that with a male director. You don't say, this is a story about a woman, so I really, you know, this is a story about a man, so we must have a male director. You just assume it's going to be a male director.
Right.
And if it's a story about a woman, more often than not, it's been a male director. So why is it now that everybody has this awareness of female directors that they have to tell female stories?
Yeah.
But yeah, I think that women have a greater opportunity to tell more authentic stories about women because they're women, they've experienced it. But like any fiction, they can write stories for men. Men can write stories for women, and you know. It's so imbalanced, but
I always say there'll be true equality when women can do really bad work and still just keep on going. The mediocrity is like, you know, as long as they're as mediocre as men.
Yeah, not just that. I just saw this beautiful French magazine cover with Pierce Brosnan, and he just could not look more handsome. It's the most handsome he's ever looked. He's got these, you know, these spots, these, I don't know if they're freckles or a little bit of sun, and like beautiful skin and like hard wrinkles and this graying beard, and it's just this like gorgeous photo. But if that were a woman, you'd say, "Ooh, she looks rough. We can't put that on the cover of a magazine." She just wouldn't have the same opportunity to look that way. So why is it beautiful with a man, but with a woman it would be
rough? So it's funny, if you see Catherine Ross now, who's, you know, 60 something,
she
still looks incredible. She hasn't had any work done, and she looks like a woman of her age, but she's still gorgeous.
Yeah, of course.
It's just we don't keep ourselves open to
that. But even to say, like, she's still gorgeous is something that's a problem, because men, you're not saying, oh, he's still gorgeous. You're saying, wow, look how handsome he is. Or he's gotten even more handsome. You wouldn't say, oh, Pierce Brosnan's still handsome. Of course he's still handsome. The fact that we even attach a still to it is problematic, even though we're giving a compliment. You know, so it's just like, it's such a big thing for us to wrap our heads around. But I'm just so glad that that's even a conversation, that we can have this conversation, that we're even aware that we can be that, you know, sensitive to the way we speak. But long way to go. But, you know, this industry, we're lucky in this industry that these are our problems. You know, there's so many businesses where women, you know, aren't having this voice or this uprising. There's so many. Beyond that, I mean, women are being sex trafficked all over the world. So to complain about roles for women in Hollywood is just a drop in the bucket.
Well, but like anything else, it's real if you're in it, you know? It's like,
yeah, it's real if you're in it. It is. But that's, you know, it's important that we shine a light on all that other.
Well, you have two daughters to raise into a better place.
I do.
So
I'm
grateful
to have two girls.
They're going to have a better generation, hopefully.
Yeah, yeah.
Each one better.
They will. I feel good about that. I do. I'm glad I have two girls that I can take everything that I've learned and unlearned, mainly things I've unlearned, and try to help guide them. And I have a husband who's just perfect for raising girls. He is.
Thank you so much for
Thank
your time.
Thank you.
Appreciate
nice to
it.
Talk to you. Thank you. Sorry my mom called us.
It's okay. Love mom.
God.